Now we're approaching the 250th anniversary when 13 colonies of the British Empire, located on the North American continent, declared their independence from Great Britain. The date was July 4th, 1776. 13 different colonies, connected geographically but totally different. Different backgrounds, different cultures, different beliefs and values. They came together over one unifying belief, that it is a natural right for all people to live in freedom. Freedom to make their own choices in life. Freedom to choose. These colonies had no money. They had no munitions, no armies. They had no allies around the world. They just knew they wanted to be free. So they took on the leading superpower in the world and won independence. And although there's been much documentation of the characters and events that led to winning our independence, these are the untold stories of American independence. Stories that tell how it all happened. Stories that will inspire. Stories that can teach and model the principles and values of the founders and how those are still relevant today. Some of them you may know, some may be new to you. All will be filled with facts and actual words that the founders said and the actions they did to win our freedom. If you recall from part one, George Rogers Clark was a surveyor and a frontiersman in Kentucky. Originally from Virginia, he moved to Kentucky in the early 1770s to survey the land, buy some land, and make his fortune. He was a compatriot of Daniel Boone and James Herod and others of the pioneers of that time. The problem in Kentucky was they were being raided by native tribes across the Ohio who were being supported by the British. And as the War for Independence started in 1776 and 1777, the British were paying the natives to attack Kentucky settlements, and the lieutenant governor in Detroit, Henry Hamilton, was known as Henry the Hairbuyer because he was paying British pounds for American scalps. So George Rogers Clark, as a captain of the militia, goes back to the Virginia legislature, and Virginia at that time claimed all the land of Kentucky and Ohio, and he convinced them to support him. Now, the governor of Virginia was a good friend of his, Patrick Henry. He was the family lawyer, and so he convinced Patrick Henry that George Rogers Clark, he could conquer three forts on the Mississippi and Ohio rivers, Fort Sackville and Vincennes, the fort at Kaskaskia, and the fort at Cahokia on the Mississippi, just across from St. Louis. He felt if he captured those forts, he'd need about 500 men to do that. And with 500 men, he could capture those forts and then go on and take Detroit from the British. That would then end the raids across the Ohio River. So the Virginia legislature gives him orders to go and defend the frontier, and he can raise 500 men. He planned on raising 350 in Virginia and another 150 on the Kentucky frontier. The governor, Patrick Henry, gave him secret orders to go ahead and attack Detroit. So he sets off, and when we last left our podcast, they had sailed from Pittsburgh down the Ohio River. When he left Pittsburgh, he thought he would have 300 men, Virginians, with him, but he could only raise 150. And when he got down to the Kentucky River, just north of the Kentucky settlements, where he expected to get another 150 men, he in fact only had 25 men. So now with 175 men, he is sailing down the Ohio, and he still decides to go because he wrote this. He said, "I knew our cause was desperate, and the more I reflected on my weakness, the more I was pleased with the enterprise." He believed so strongly that the people needed protecting, and he had 175 willing, passionate men. He could do this. Now, up to this point, he hasn't even told the men what he's going to do. So they sail a few more days down the Ohio River and come to a spot called the Falls of the Ohio. And the Falls of the Ohio is basically the location of today's Louisville, Kentucky. At the Falls of the Ohio, they land on Corn Island, a little island that's just in front of the falls. And at Corn Island, they build a fort. And he begins training his men. They arrive there on May 27th, and they start building a fort, and he's training his men to fight as a unit. He picks some of the weaker, the lesser interested men, and leaves them behind to guide the fort. And then they set off for the Mississippi River, down the Ohio on flatboats for the Mississippi River. They leave on June 24th. As they're sailing away down the Ohio River, an eclipse comes and turns the whole sky dark. What would normally scare most men, and many of the men were panicked, George Rogers Clark, in his psychological wisdom, he was great at just persuading and influencing and inspiring people. He said, this is an omen that we are going to put an end to these raids. So they sail for 5 days, and they get down to near the Mississippi River, where the Ohio flows in the Mississippi. And he had sent spies ahead, and he knew that the British were watching that juncture of the river. So he decides to stop short of the Mississippi River and continue overland. And they have to march about 120 miles overland to the town of Kaskaskia. Of the three towns they're going after, Kaskaskia is right in the middle, and it's the largest of the settlements. Cahokia is farther up the Mississippi River across from St. Louis, and Vincennes is a little farther east. So they decide to go for the biggest city, Kaskaskia. And as they're marching, they run into a bunch of hunters, a small band of hunters, who they're not sure whose side they're on. Because remember that the Illinois country was basically settled by French settlers. The French Canadians, Canada was a province of France. And so in the early 1700s, people like Father Pierre Marquette and Louis Joliet had explored the Great Lakes, and they explored south of the Great Lakes and the towns, the present site of Chicago, the present site of Joliet, Illinois, and they had started forming communities there, and they're mostly French settlers. In the 1750s, we had the French and Indian War. It was fought mostly on the North American continent, but in Europe, it was called the 7 Years' War, and the ending battle of the 7 Years' War took place in Quebec, Canada, on the Plains of Abraham, and the British had a decisive victory, and so they gained Canada as a new province. Now, it wasn't considered a colony, so it operated under different rules, but all the French people in the Quebec province now became British citizens. So the Illinois country is settled by mostly French Canadians, but they're under the rule of the British, and this doesn't sit well. They're not really happy. They are afraid of the British. They have been abused by the British. And they also saw how the Indians under the British were treating the American prisoners that were captured in Kentucky and taken back as slaves. So the French were no friends of the British. And when George Rogers Clark had sent spies ahead to the towns of Kaskaskia and Cahokia, they learned that the French settlers were more sympathetic to the American cause. The problem was the British had told the French settlers all kinds of lies, that the Americans were wild and crazy, that they ate people, they were cannibals. They spread all kinds of rumors. So George Rogers Clark and his men are now marching from the Ohio River across southern, what's today is southern Illinois, 120 miles, and they're going to Kaskaskia. They arrive at Kaskaskia and they surround it. And they march around to make it look like they have a much bigger force. They make a lot of noise. The residents and there's just a few British soldiers there, mostly French militia, are very afraid. They send out their priest, and he was the priest for the entire Illinois country. His name was Father Gibault. Father Gibault comes out to negotiate with George Rogers Clark. At the time, George Rogers Clark, his style of negotiating was to be very upfront and bold and demanding, and then afterwards to be more patient and kind. But upfront, he believed scarum with power and might. So he would not agree to anything that the people were afraid he was going to separate the wives from their husbands, that he was going to take the husbands captive, that they were going to violate the women. But as he talks to Father Gibault, he realizes that the French are really sympathetic. And Father Gibault says, look, we don't really want to be British. We like what you're doing in the new United States. And he says, we would like to support you. So they arrange a surrender. And then George Rogers Clark pulls a piece of paper out of his packet, and he says, look at this. Here's the latest news from the East. You may not have known that the British surrendered. Burgoyne's entire army surrendered at a place called Saratoga. And because of that major victory, they surrendered 3,000 troops. People in Europe are starting to pay attention to the new American colonies. And the French have decided to support. So as former French people, you're really on our side. So he captures Kaskaskia without firing a shot. He enlists the French militia, gets the residents to take an oath of allegiance to the new United States, and he sets up his headquarters there at Kaskaskia. Now, he sends two small forces, one a little north and up the Mississippi to Cahokia, right across from St. Louis, And in Cahokia, the same thing happens. The Father Gibault goes with them, and they capture Cahokia without firing a shot. And all the people of Cahokia then sign a Pledge of Allegiance, and the French militia works with him. And then he sends Major Bowen to Vincennes east. Now, Vincennes is on the Wabash River, which today separates Indiana from Illinois. At that time, it was all called the Illinois Country. But it's a direct route from Vincennes up the Wabash River to Detroit. So Major Bowen goes with just two Americans and a small contingent of French militia from Kaskaskia, and he goes up there, and they again negotiate with the French militia in and the few British soldiers that are there. And what they say is Father Gibault tells them what's happened in the other two towns, but there are some British soldiers who maintain they must fight. So what George Rogers Clark says to them at Vincennes, or his man does, Major Bowen, says, "Everybody who is going to support the Americans, go to your homes, stay out of the fort, and stay inside your homes. Those who want to side with the British, stay inside your fort, but you better be prepared to fight." So after a day of surrounding the fort and shooting at them, the small contingent decides to surrender. And so now George Rogers Clark has accomplished, without any injuries to his own side, capturing three towns, three forts, all of the British. The plan now is to hold those forts and in the following year raise a force and go take Detroit. Meanwhile, George Rogers Clark goes up the Mississippi River to Cahokia, the little town across from St. Louis, and he is called Long Knife because the Americans had long hunting knives. In fact, they were longer knives than the Indians used for scalping purposes and skinning purposes, but the Americans carried a longer knife, so they were called Long Knives. And the Indians had heard much about George Rogers Clark and the Kentucky, Virginia fighting forces and how good they were, and they were very fearful. So George Rogers Clark gets them in Cahokia, and for a period of about 3 weeks, he meets with up to 10 different tribal chieftains. And each day, or every day or so, another tribal chieftain comes in, and they have negotiations. And again, George Rogers Clark was full of boldness. He was full of confidence. And he would say to each of the tribal chieftains, "You have heard of me. I am the great Long Knife. You have heard of how successful I am as a fighter. I bring with you two belts. I bring you two belts." And to the native tribes, a belt was a sign of a contract or a covenant. And he said, "I have a red belt here of war, or I have a white belt of peace. You may choose whichever belt you have, the white belt or the red belt. If you choose the white belt, we will settle and we will live peaceably. If you choose the red belt, when you leave here today, you better come back prepared tomorrow to die." All of the tribal chieftains decided to take the white belt of peace. So basically, he pacified all of the tribal activity in the Illinois country, the states of Indiana and Illinois, with that little statement. Today, if you go to the Illinois state capitol, there is a huge mural of George Rogers Clark and the meeting the tribal chieftains and holding the two belts of peace. It's about 20 feet high in the Illinois capitol, and it's an astounding mural, actually. So he's pacified the area. It's the end of 1778. He's pacified the area. He has the three towns in his possession. They're getting ready next year. He sends notes back to Virginia, and they're getting ready now to march on Detroit. Meanwhile, up in Detroit, Henry Hamilton, the lieutenant governor, a former officer in the British Army, and Major Hay, his leading British soldier in the area of Detroit, raise 500 people, many of them tribal natives, and some British soldiers, and they sail down the Wabash in December and recapture Vincennes, Fort Sackville, the British fort. And when they capture it, they take Major Bowen and one other person hostage, and they hold him, and they rebuild Fort Sackville. Now, it's the middle of December. Typically, in that time of year, there is no fighting that goes on. It was very primitive conditions in Vincennes. Detroit had nicer homes, nicer places to live. So when they rebuild the fort at the end of December, Henry Hamilton, the governor, says, "I'm going to stay here with Major Hay," but he releases most of his soldiers and the natives to go back to their homes and the comfort, and he says, "We're going to get back together in the spring, in March or April, and we'll go retake our towns." So he leaves just a small force of about 50 people with him, and they all leave. Meanwhile, over in Kaskaskia, now George Rogers Clark hears that the British have come down and recaptured Vincennes. And so he says to himself, what can we do? In fact, he writes a letter to Patrick Henry, the governor, saying they have an overwhelming force. If I let them stay until the spring, there is no way we can fight that many people. So I'm going to have to do something. I either have to leave the area or I'm going to have to put a force together and attack them. I only have 175 men. As he wrote to Patrick Henry, he said, the case is desperate. Quit the country or attack. Great things, though, have been effected by a few men well-conducted, well-led. So he decides, against all odds, to take his small group of people. He doesn't know that the British have mostly left the fort empty. And he decides to march to Vincennes. It's 180 miles. Now, that part of southern Illinois and southern Indiana, in the wintertime, the rivers flood. And so as they march out, a three-week march, they decide to send some supplies by a big riverboat, and they put two cannon on it. But unfortunately, the riverboat never makes it back to them on time. It arrives back after all the fighting is done. But as they're marching across, the first week goes fine, mostly dry, but then they start coming on the flooded rivers, and they're marching knee-high to waist-high water. Each man is carrying a rifle that weighs 16 to 18 pounds, plus all his supplies, and they're holding it over their head for hours and hours at a time. This is one of the most epic marches in American military history, and sadly, hardly talked about these days. They march day after day. They find little islands in the flooded plains where they can sleep at night and stay somewhat dry, make a fire. Then they march out again, go off the little hills and back into the flooded areas. When they come to a river, they don't even know exactly where the riverbed is. All of a sudden, they're walking along, and then they fall into a river 6, 8, 10, 12 feet over their heads. They build a couple dugout canoes to get the sick and the supplies across those river spots. Then they all keep walking in waist-high water. They march on and on. In fact, as they're marching along, George Rogers Clark, always an inspiring person, sends several of his captains and leaders ahead. And they go ahead of the others. They find a dry land, an island, and they call back to the others and say, it's dry from here on. Come on, we can get this far. And when they get to that dry land, they see more water and then another dry land. And so he's got people egging them on and guiding them on. The little drummer boy who traveled with them, at one time, the water was so over his head, he was floating on his drum as he came. But eventually they reach Vincennes, and they come the night before, and they surround the town of Vincennes. They sneak into Vincennes, and again they get the local militia to say, stay in your homes, stay out of the fort. And then they surround the fort. And from the town's homes, they begin the sharpshooters. Now, the British carried muskets. British soldiers were not very accurate. Their fire was intended for close in. Americans mostly carried rifles, which were bored and were very accurate. So the Americans were screaming and yelling, marching around, waving flags from behind the houses that surrounded the fort, and made it look like they had hundreds and hundreds of people, when in fact they only had about 150 to 175 people. And as they're showing they're screaming and whistling and whooping, and then the riflemen begin picking off. Every time the British peek out of the fort, one of the riflemen fires and kills a British soldier. They try to fire some cannon, but they can't get the cannon ports open. They finally do fire cannon twice and destroy two homes and injure some of the local civilians. This goes on for a day and a half, and finally, Lieutenant Governor Henry Hamilton comes out for a peace mission. And George Rogers Clark will refuse him everything. He said, there are no terms or no conditions. It's unconditional surrender. He said, and in fact, I intend to punish people who have raided the people of Kentucky. And he looks right at Major Hay and he says, you are one of them. If you decide to fight and you don't surrender unconditionally, then when we attack, I will punish you because you have been leading some of these raids into Kentucky. So while they go back into the fort, and just then, two chieftains come up, a small band of Indians come up. They're returning from a raid in Kentucky, and they think that George Rogers Clark's men are the British, and so they whoop and holler, and then they get captured. The Kentuckians recognize these two chieftains as people who led raids, so they put them out on the parade ground in front of the fort, in front of the view of all the soldiers, and they tomahawk them to death. This really scares the people inside the fort, and after the second day, they come out and they surrender unconditionally. And then we go to the very beginning of our story where we started on February 25th of 1779. An early morning with the cold wind blowing across the parade ground, the Americans raised the American flag over Fort Sackville, now named Fort Patrick Henry. And the instant they do that, they not only capture the Illinois country, but there are five states that come into the possession, the territory of five states, Ohio, Michigan, Indiana, Illinois, and Wisconsin, all come unto the possession of the new United States, essentially doubling the size of the United States territory on that one day. Now, the Americans maintained possession of that fort throughout the war. Although several attempts were made to conquer Detroit, they never could raise enough men and had other difficulties keeping the war going in the east, so they never captured Detroit. In fact, Detroit does not become part of the United States again until the War of 1812, when the British vacated them. Now, what can we learn from George Rogers Clark? What are some of the lessons? Number one, stay focused on what you do. Have your goal in mind and keep your eye on the goal. Don't let anything deter you. Number two, be bold. Be bold. Take chances. Take risks. That's what George Rogers Clark did, and look what happened. Also, be fair with people. Once George Rogers Clark negotiated peace, he was extremely generous and fair to the people. He captured Henry Hamilton and Major Hay and then sent them back in captivity, but he let everybody else go in that fort. Finally, be persistent. Don't give up. When you have a goal in sight, be persistent, or as we would say, press on regardless. That's what George Rogers Clark and his men did on that epic 180-mile march through the swampland of southern Illinois and Indiana. They pressed on regardless, and as a result, five new states came into the Union of the United States. Thank you for joining us today and listening to the untold stories of American independence, celebrating 250 years since the Declaration of Independence. I encourage you to follow us on social media. You can also subscribe to our YouTube channel, and you'll find more information about the stories we tell, books or reference, and other ways that you can be involved in telling these stories of independence to other people. Thank you for your support, and thank you for living and believing in the American way. Press on.